Good evening. So glad to be here tonight. We've been blessed with a beautiful late spring day today that we've been able to enjoy. And now we have this opportunity to come together this evening and to focus on spiritual matters, matters of eternal importance. And we're so grateful to be able to do that. If you would take a Bible and open to Ephesians chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5 is where we'll begin in our study together this evening. I appreciate our brother Mike leading us in those songs having to do with the church, and both of those songs will tie in with the things that we're going to study about here for the next few minutes. It's so good to see so many out, and there are some new faces that are here tonight that haven't seen the past couple of nights, and so we're glad for that and appreciate those who are visiting here. We've got Ryan and Eli Dalton who have worshiped with us in Kentucky. Well, Ryan's been away at school for the past few years, but they made the trip down earlier today, and I told them the preaching is not going to make the trip worth it. But they said, well, we're going on to Charleston, and so that's going to balance things out and make it worthwhile after all, I guess. It's good to see them and have them with us. I want to talk to you this evening, as was mentioned earlier, about overcoming threats to the local church. As we've been discussing the theme of trusting God in troublesome times, one of the things that we need to do as we trust God is that we need to maintain strength and purity in the local church. And so the things that we're going to study about tonight are very specific to the strength and purity of this local church that meets here, but not only the one that meets here, but the things that we'll discuss apply to any local body of God's people, wherever it may be meeting. So as we begin to think about these things this evening, we understand as we read in Scripture that as a body of Christians, the local church should be pure and should be holy and should be strong in the faith. Notice with me in Ephesians chapter 5, where the Apostle Paul writes of the purity that the Lord expects. In Ephesians chapter 5, he says, beginning in verse 25, "Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her, that he might sanctify and cleanse her with the washing of water by the word, that he might present her to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that she should be holy and without blemish." Here the church is pictured as the bride of Christ, and what we want to key in on is the idea that the Lord expects all things having to do with the church to be holy, to be without blemish, without spot, without defect. Purity is what is under consideration here. Now let's think about the strength aspect of this. The same apostle wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 3. And in verse 15, he said to Timothy, as he talked about his plans, he said, "But if I am delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." The church is the pillar and ground of the truth, or that's what it should be. And that signifies to us strength in upholding God's will, upholding God's truth in this world. That's what the church is supposed to be doing. Each local church that belongs to Christ is composed of members who have been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. In Acts chapter 20, we have the Apostle Paul speaking to the elders of the church of Ephesus. And here on this occasion, notice what he says to them in verse 28 of Acts 20. "Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood." The church, the local church, is a collection of people who have been bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. Each congregation must be kept pure from the polluting and corrupting influence of sin. At the same time, Each congregation must maintain its spiritual strength and vitality. Now, what I want to mention here for a moment is that whether we realize it or not, we face an enemy who does not want those things to happen. The devil would love nothing more than to weaken and defile the local church. As a church, we think about our relationship in the local church, we are not fighting physical battles, right? We're not using physical weapons of carnal warfare to advance the cause of Christ. But make no mistake about it, we are fighting battles, spiritual battles, against a spiritual enemy. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 12, the Apostle Paul puts it this way. He says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places." We're not in a flesh and blood physical fight. We're in a spiritual fight for our lives. Now, in this battle, in this war that's being waged, what we have to understand is that we're up against a powerful enemy. And in fact, Satan already has the world on his side. You realize that? In 1 John chapter 5 and verse 19, the Apostle John says, "We know that we are of God, and the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one." There's no neutral ground. People like to think, "Well, you know, I don't worship Satan. I'm a good person. I don't really do anything too bad. I mean, I'm not a follower of Christ. I don't get into all that, but I'm not on Satan's side." Well, there are only two sides to be on. You're either on the Lord's side or you are under the sway of the devil. That's the reality of the situation. And so since the devil already has the world under his sway, what is left for him? Well, what he's hoping and trying to accomplish is to find some way to destroy God's people. That's his challenge. The Apostle Peter, in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8, issues this warning to Christians: "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour." Now, as we think about the devil walking about as a roaring lion, the thing that we need to recognize is that he does not always appear like a roaring lion. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, the Apostle Paul points that out. Notice what he says in verses 14 and 15 here of 2 Corinthians 11. He says, "And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works." Satan is out to destroy God's people by whatever means necessary, whatever he has at his disposal, whatever deception he can muster. And he's coming for this local church. Now, we need to be aware of those things that threaten to destroy the strength and the purity of the local church. If we don't see the threats and dangers for what they are, then we will not be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. But if we can see the threats, if we can recognize them, if we can arm ourselves, then we can overcome these threats before they overcome us. So what we want to do for the next few minutes tonight is to examine some key threats to the strength and the purity of the local church and to talk about how we can overcome those threats. First of all, let's consider the threat of worldliness among the members of the church. But what is worldliness? Well, we have that term used in Titus chapter 2 in verse 11, term worldly. And notice the context here is Paul is writing to Titus and instructing Titus, the younger preacher, concerning the things that he should be teaching and preaching. In Titus 2 in verses 11 and 12, Paul says, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age." And to be worldly is to follow the ways of the world instead of following the ways of the Lord. Now that's a problem, because we already read a few moments ago in 1 John 5 that the world is under the sway of the wicked one. So to be worldly is to follow what everyone else is doing who is under the sway of the devil. The term worldliness describes the lifestyle of those who are outside the body of Christ, those who are living in sin along with the rest of the world. As Christians, we've been called out of the world by the gospel of Christ. But there is always the danger that a child of God will turn back to the ways of the world. There is always the danger that in that circumstance, a child of God may bring the ways of the world into the local church. And that is why the Bible constantly warns that we should guard ourselves against taking on the sinful ways of the world. Think about Romans chapter 12 and the warning that's given at the beginning of that chapter. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Paul says, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you may present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Do you know what he means when he says, "Do not be conformed to this world"? What he's saying is, don't be like everybody else. Don't take on the ways of the world. Don't act like everyone else acts. In James chapter 1, in verse 27, James says, "Pure and undefiled religion before God and the Father is this, to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world." Unspotted from the world. In other words, those sinful stains of the world are not getting on us because we're not engaging in the things that the world is engaging in. Worldly behavior threatens the strength and the purity of the church. Now, sadly, what happens is that many Christians ignore all of these warnings that we've just looked at and become involved in the sins that are so common among the people of the world. Members of the church sometimes drift into a worldly lifestyle thinking nothing is wrong. Now here's the danger. Thinking nothing is wrong because everyone else is living the same way. And there are many examples of worldliness that we can name. The social drinking, social and recreational drinking of intoxicating drink. Well, that's what everybody does, right? I mean, you just kick back and knock back a few cold ones from time to time. I mean, that's how everybody lives. Well, that's how the world lives. The use of foul language. Well, everybody talks that way. I mean, come on, you know. Guy made me mad. He cut me off in traffic. And it's just commonplace to utter some of those words. Dancing? And when I talk about dancing, I mean, there are different kinds of dancing. Let's make that clear. What I'm talking about is the kind of dancing that takes place between people who are not married to one another, which is really lasciviousness, as the Bible defines it, where you have things that are going on in that situation that should only be going on really between a husband and wife in private. And yet, many people want to get involved in dancing. Brethren sometimes want to get involved in that kind of dancing. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. Well, everybody does that. Entertaining ourselves with the ungodly forms of entertainment that are so popular, that include filthy talk and sexual immorality depicted on screen and all this kind of thing. Well, we're going to entertain ourselves with that because that's what there is. That's what's out there. That's what's available. The wearing of immodest and revealing clothing in public. Displaying our bodies in front of the world. Whether it's at the beach or at the lake or the pool or just out around town or whatever it may be, exposing ourselves. Well, that's what the worldly people do. And there's a hypocrisy. You know, people often say, well, I don't want to be a member of that church. You know, they're just a bunch of hypocrites. Well, sadly, sometimes that's true. And that's a worldly way to behave, to do differently from what you are taught and to fail to practice what you preach. Now, you can run down that list and say, but everybody does those things. Well, yeah, that's why it's called worldliness. And that's what makes it so dangerous. The purity of the church is destroyed when the body becomes filled with the blemishes and the stains of sin. We need to see the dangerous threat of worldliness. Notice in Galatians chapter 5 what Paul calls the works of the flesh. And just see how many of these things are commonly accepted by the world and are part of the worldly lifestyle. And notice what the Apostle Paul says about these things in Galatians 5, 19 through 21. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. We can choose to act like the world and imitate the world, but what we do in the process is we leave God behind. And those that do that will not inherit the kingdom of God. We need to overcome the danger and the threat of worldliness that threatens to invade and destroy the local church. Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5 and verses 8 through 11, writing to the Christians in Ephesus, "For you were once darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them." That's how you overcome the threat of worldliness in the church. You don't get along with it. You don't get comfortable with it. You don't dabble in some of it. You expose it, and you have no fellowship with it, no part in it. Worldliness threatens to destroy the strength and the purity of the church. You need to guard against the danger. Now, let's think about the threat of a lack of proper church discipline. The church, as we read in the New Testament, the local church must exercise discipline, we might say, when members of the church are overtaken by sin, caught up in sin, and refuse to repent. When a brother or sister becomes involved in sin, what we're supposed to do as a congregation is to try and help that person out of the sin. In Galatians chapter 6 and verse 1, Paul says, "Brethren, if a man is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted." Here you have a situation where a member of the church has gotten caught up in some sin. The spiritually minded members are to work with that individual, encourage and exhort that individual, correct that individual, so that restoration can take place. So that that person can be right with God again. Well, what if he or she refuses to repent? Refuses to change? Well, then the church has to take some action in order to keep that situation, which is already bad, from becoming even worse than it already is. Now, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul gives some direct instruction along these lines to the church in Thessalonica. And he says there in 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 6, "But we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly and not according to the tradition which you received from us." Now, he's using the word tradition there, not in the sense that we often use it. He's using tradition to represent the things taught by the apostles, the instruction given by the Lord. Those who are not following, those who are disorderly, those who have gotten entangled in sin, the church must withdraw from them. Notice later on in that same chapter, in verses 14 and 15, "And if anyone does not obey our word in this epistle, note that person and do not keep company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet do not count him as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother." We're talking about members of the church here, a brother in Christ. And notice what Paul meant when he talked earlier in the chapter about withdrawing is this: note that person and do not keep company with him so that he will be ashamed of his conduct. The idea is that he will recognize then that he has been wrong and he will repent, make correction. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, we have an entire chapter devoted to this subject. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, we read at the beginning of the chapter how there was a man in the church in Corinth who was engaged in sexual immorality, and the church was not addressing the problem in the way that they needed to. And so the instruction is given by Paul here, picking up in verse 5. He says, "Deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, that his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, was sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote to you in my epistle not to keep company with sexually immoral people. Yet, I certainly did not mean with the sexually immoral people of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or idolaters. Since then, you would need to go out of the world. But now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral, or covetous, or an idolater, or a reviler, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person." Notice the focus is on the local church. What's going on within the local church? The behavior of the members of the church. He says, we can't control what those people out there in the world are doing. You can't leave this world to get away from all the immoral people in the world. But you can do something, and you must do something about the conduct of those who are within the local church. The congregation may have to publicly mark, note, this individual has become unfaithful, is caught up in sin, will not repent, and then avoid, withdraw from that brother or sister who is in sin and refuses to repent. Don't socialize with that one. Don't even eat with such a person, Paul says here. This is the Lord's plan when it comes to dealing with sin in the congregation. A lack of exercising this discipline threatens the strength and the purity of the local church. There is sometimes a tendency to overlook sin in the lives of the members of the church. Instead of trying to encourage this sinning brother to repent, instead of taking the proper scriptural action, if he refuses to repent, too often what happens in local churches is nothing. Nothing. We need to guard against that lazy tendency. There are two important purposes involved in church discipline that we need to clearly see. Going back to 1 Corinthians 5 and verses 5 and 6 again. Notice first that the point of exercising this discipline is to save the soul of the one who's caught up in sin. Don't ever lose sight of that. Paul says in verse 5, deliver such a one to Satan for the destruction of the flesh. Why? That his spirit may be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Everything's not okay here. We've got this brother or sister who's involved in sin and who won't repent. What's going to happen if that continues? That person is going to be lost eternally. We want that individual to be saved. We love the soul of that individual. That's one of the key purposes involved in taking this action. But secondly, you'll notice in verse 6, the point of church discipline is to prevent that sinful influence from spreading and working its way through the whole congregation. And that's the point that Paul makes in verse 6 when he says, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Brother or sister so-and-so is caught up in sin. Nobody's saying anything about it. Nobody's doing anything about it. I know what she's done. I know what he's involved in. Nobody's saying anything about it. Nobody's going to do anything about it. Well, I guess I can do some things I've been wanting to do too. And nobody's going to say anything to me. And before long, you know, somebody, well, I guess if he can do that and she can do that and they can be, well, I guess I can go do this. You see how a little leaven leavens the whole, you see how it works through the congregation? You see how the purity and strength of the congregation is completely destroyed? If we fail to do the Lord's will when it comes to discipline in the local church, we will be guilty of destroying the purity and strength of the church. I'll tell you, you don't want to stand before the Lord in judgment guilty of having destroyed His church because you wouldn't follow His instruction. That is a threat that is very real. Now, I'm not suggesting, please don't misunderstand, I'm not suggesting that the church here is failing to carry out those responsibilities. You may very well, and I have every confidence in the congregation here to think that you are, when these situations arise, fulfilling this instruction. But what about in the future? What about next time something like this happens? What's going to happen then? What will go on the next time there's a need to address a problem like this? Guard against the danger. Guard against the threat of failing to act when action should be taken. Now, we also need to be aware of another threat to the strength and purity of the local church, and that is the threat of weak preaching and teaching. It's been said, and I think it's fairly accurate in some ways, that it's possible to judge the strength and the purity of a local church based on the kind of preaching and teaching that it promotes and demands. The Bible is very clear concerning the kind of preaching and the kind of teaching that must be done in order to please God and in order to save souls. Strong preaching and teaching that is based on preaching and teaching the gospel of Christ in its power and simplicity. That's what is needed. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, Notice what the Apostle Paul says about the preaching that was done in Corinth. In 1 Corinthians 2, picking up in verse 1 here at the beginning of the chapter, Paul says to the church there, "And I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with excellence of speech or of wisdom, declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling, and my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not be in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God." That's the kind of preaching and teaching that is needed. It's not about the excellence of speech. It's not about human wisdom. It's not about persuasive words that come from men. It's about preaching Christ and Him crucified so that people put their faith in the Lord and in His Word. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul sums it up this way. 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2, he says to Timothy, "Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching." This is the only kind of preaching and teaching that will convict sinners, that will strengthen the saved, and that will please the Lord. It's the kind of teaching and preaching that makes reference to book, chapter, and verse for all that is taught and all that is done and all that is believed and practiced. It's the kind of teaching and preaching that makes the will of God clear and plain for all to see and all to understand. Weak preaching and teaching threaten the strength and the purity of the church. And we need to recognize that there is a balance that should be present in our preaching and teaching. The balance is presented right here. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. You see the balance there? True gospel preaching involves both exhortation and rebuke. It includes the approval of that which is good. And at the same time, it includes the exposure of that which is false and in error. It includes preaching about the promise of heaven for the saved, for the faithful. And it also includes preaching about the promise of hell for those who are unfaithful. Strong preaching and teaching will point out sin and error by name and will call upon those who are in sin and those who are in error to repent and obey the Lord. That is the kind of preaching and teaching that was done by Jesus and His apostles. And that is the kind of preaching and teaching that is needed today. Now let me tell you something. If our preaching and teaching lacks Scripture, if it's just very general and generic, and it's just designed to leave everybody kind of feeling okay all the time, then we are failing to preach and teach the gospel of Jesus Christ. If it's just a bunch of storytelling, if it's as if, as I've seen sometimes, a man gets up in the pulpit and does a stand-up comedy routine, if it's filled with speculation, well, the Bible doesn't really say this, but you know, I think, you've got a problem. You've got a problem. I'll tell you what, I fear for my brethren sometimes. When I visit various congregations and gospel meetings and hear the sermons that are preached, and I hear a brother get up and base his whole sermon around a movie that he watched instead of basing it on God's Word, I'll tell you what, it's not about getting a business leadership book and getting up and preaching that as a gospel sermon. I've been to gospel meetings. I can't tell you how many times this has happened. I've heard more John Maxwell than I've heard John the Apostle presented from the pulpit. That's not gospel. That's not the kind of preaching that is prescribed in the New Testament. And you can be sure that we will weaken the church and we will fill it with impurity if our preaching and our teaching are weak. We need to guard against those threats. It may not be what's popular. People like to have their ears tickled, as Paul goes on to say there in 2 Timothy chapter 4. People like to be entertained. People like to just feel like everything's okay all the time. That's not the way the Lord preached. That's not the way the apostles and prophets preached. We need to make the will of God known. That's the responsibility that we have. Now, again, I'm not suggesting that that's not what goes on here on a regular basis. I know a little bit of the history of this congregation and the kind of preaching that it demands. I know the kind of preaching that Stan Adams does. I know the kind of preaching that Stephen Deaton does. I know the kind of preaching that the men do that are involved in gospel meeting efforts here regularly. And so I'm not suggesting that that's not happening here, but what will it be like in the future? What kind of preaching will you expect? And more importantly, what kind of preaching and teaching will you demand? Don't let the church be destroyed because of weak, watered-down teaching and preaching. Now, another threat to the strength and purity of the local church that we need to work on overcoming is the threat of a lack of qualified elders. God's plan is for the church to have elders. They're called by different designations in Scripture which relate to their role. Sometimes they're called overseers, sometimes they're called bishops, sometimes they're called shepherds or pastors. These are the men who have been appointed to oversee the affairs of the local church. They're responsible for shepherding the flock, as the Apostle Peter talks about in 1 Peter chapter 5. In verses 1 through 3, he addresses them. He says, "The elders who are among you I exhort, I who am a fellow elder and a witness of the sufferings of Christ and also a partaker of the glory that will be revealed. Shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not by compulsion but willingly, not for dishonest gain but eagerly, nor as being lords over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock." This is the job of these men. They're the shepherds, the overseers, guiding the church in what is right. They're charged with the responsibility of watching out for the souls of the members of the congregation. In Hebrews chapter 13 and verse 17, the inspired writer says, "Obey those who rule over you and be submissive, for they watch out for your souls as those who must give account. Let them do so with joy and not with grief, for that would be unprofitable for you." God's plan is for each local church to have a plurality of men serving as elders, serving as overseers. We notice in the preaching that was done by the Apostle Paul in his first journey that's recorded in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 14, as Paul and Barnabas were traveling around and preaching the gospel in various cities and churches were established, they came back through where those churches had been established toward the end of that journey. And in Acts 14 and verse 23, we read, "So when they had appointed elders in every church and prayed with fasting, they commended them to the Lord in whom they had believed." Elders in every church. That's what God desires. That's God's plan for the church. But you know, not everyone can take on the responsibility of serving as an elder in the local church. There are qualifications that a man must meet before he can be appointed to take on that task. Notice 1 Timothy, the third chapter, beginning in verse 1. Paul says, "This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. A bishop then must be blameless." Remember, bishop, elder, overseer, these are interchangeable terms. Pastor, it's all the same thing. "A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, not covetous. One who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how will he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil." The men who fit the criteria we've just read, those are the ones who can be appointed to shepherd the flock. In Titus chapter 1, we have a similar list given by the same apostle. "If a man is blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of dissipation or insubordination. For a bishop must be blameless as a steward of God, not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but hospitable, a lover of what is good, sober-minded, just, holy, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word as he's been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and convict those who contradict." A lack of qualified men serving in this role as elders, that is a severe threat to the strength and to the purity of the local church. There are three problems in particular that often arise when it comes to elders in the local church. The first problem is, and it's a very common one, that there may not be enough men who meet the qualifications we've just read in order to serve as elders. And so what happens then is that the church goes without elders. You may have no men who meet all of that criteria. You may only have one man who meets all of that criteria. And so elders cannot be appointed because not enough men meet the qualifications. Now, the second problem that can arise is that maybe you do have qualified men. Maybe you do have at least two men who meet the criteria presented in Scripture, but they're not appointed. Why? Well, because if they're appointed, that means I have to give up my control and my say over how things are run in this church. We don't want that. I'm not going to allow these men to be appointed. And so you sometimes have that problem where you've got qualified men and they're not actually appointed. But I'll tell you the third problem, and it's also, sadly, at times a common one as well, is that you may have unqualified men who have been appointed and are serving as elders even though they blatantly do not fit the criteria given in Scripture. And when a church does not have qualified elders in place for any of those reasons, it lacks the oversight, the guidance, the direction that these men are supposed to be there to provide. And this is one reason why you have churches that become involved in unscriptural practices, unscriptural projects. This is one reason why church discipline is not practiced in some cases. This is one reason why things can get out of control and fall apart. It's because you don't have the guidance, the shepherding influence of these men in place as God would have it. And as a result, the church is weakened. The church becomes susceptible to corrupting influences. Notice what Paul says as we go back again to Acts chapter 20, as he talks to the elders of the church of Ephesus, picking up again in verse 28. He says to them, "Therefore take heed to yourselves and to all the flock among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God which He purchased with His own blood. For I know this, that after my departure, savage wolves will come in among you, not sparing the flock. Also from among yourselves, men will rise up, speaking perverse things to draw away the disciples after themselves. Therefore watch and remember that for 3 years I did not cease to warn everyone, night and day with tears." That's how serious this is. Wolves will come in. Men will rise up speaking perverse things. Who's going to be there to stand up and say, "We're not going to have that error taught here"? Who's going to be there to rise up and take a stand and say, "We are going to do things God's way, according to God's word. We're not going to put up with departures from it"? Who's going to be there to stand up and see to it that the wolves are kept at bay? A lack of qualified elders in place can leave the church vulnerable. And it may be that the church is striving to get to the point where it can have qualified men appointed to serve as elders. Churches can exist, as we read earlier in Acts 14, they can exist and function without elders. But the goal should be to reach the point where elders are appointed and in place. Where are the men who are preparing themselves, who are doing their diligent duty in their homes and their families to raise godly children, to show those characteristics that are needed, to show the leadership and the example of a child of God, to fit the criteria so that when the time comes, they can be appointed and the church can have the overseers that it desperately needs? Don't let the church become weak and impure because no one stepped up to serve in that role. And then let's, along with that, not overlook, as we think about threats to the strength and purity of the local church, let's not overlook the threat of a refusal to take responsibility. Every member of the church is expected to serve God to the best of his or her ability. This is what we were singing about earlier. We sang that song, "There's Room in God's Kingdom," right? For the things that you can do. There's a role, there's a responsibility for every member of the congregation. Look with me at 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians 12, beginning in verse 14. In writing to the church in Corinth, Paul says, "For in fact the body is not one member but many. If the foot should say, 'Because I'm not a hand, I'm not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, 'Because I'm not an eye, I'm not of the body,' is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? But now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body just as He pleased. And if there were all one member, where would the body be? But now indeed there are many members, yet one body." What he's describing here is he illustrates this by means of the physical human body, is that the local church, just like the human body, is made up of various parts that have different functions, but all those functions are necessary for it to function as a whole, as a healthy whole. In Ephesians chapter 4, picking up in verse 11, speaking of how God has arranged things for the church, he says, beginning in verse 11, the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians 4, "And He Himself gave some to be apostles, Some prophets, some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers. Remember, pastors are the same thing as elders. For the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, that we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the trickery of men and the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up in all things into Him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effect of working by which every part does its share, causes growth of the body for the edifying of itself in love. To edify means to build up, to strengthen spiritually. That's what we've been talking about tonight. And what Paul points out in this passage is that every member, every part of the body, every member of the church is to contribute to that process of strengthening the whole church. Now, not everyone has the same role. But the point is that we all have a role. You may not be the teacher, but you can be the listener and the learner. You may not be the song leader, but you can be the one who goes and visits the sick or the one who's in need. You may not be the one who's up preaching a sermon, but you may be able to privately comfort and encourage a brother or sister who's in some sort of troubled situation. All of these things are vital. All of these roles are important to the local church. There is something that every member can do. And there are responsibilities that all of us must take on as members of the church. And I'll tell you, when members of the church refuse to take responsibility, the strength and the purity of the church is threatened. Can the Lord count on you? Can your brethren count on you? Or are we sitting back with arms folded thinking, somebody else will handle it. Somebody else will do it. We are expected to grow as Christians, to mature, and to become responsible for doing what we can in our service to God. If we do not take responsibility, we will not grow and make progress. We will go backward. That was the problem that was addressed in Hebrews chapter 5. Here these people have been Christians for a long time, long enough to grow up and be mature and contribute. But look what the writer says, picking up in verse 12 of Hebrews 5. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. We're supposed to grow up and mature as Christians and contribute and be able to teach others and do those things that are needed in the work of the church. And it's sad when some refuse to take on even the most basic of responsibilities of the Christian, even refusing to assemble for worship with the church as often as they should. As Hebrews chapter 10 and verses 24 and 25 talks about, let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. The disastrous result so often is that you end up with a few, a handful in the church, who are doing just about everything that needs to be done, while the majority never do reach that point of maturity, never do grow up, never do take on the responsibility that they should. Don't allow the church to become weak and sick and corrupted just because you refused to act like a responsible adult and to contribute what you could to the Lord's work. Guard against the danger. I appreciate how well you have listened and have followed along this evening as we've studied these things. We have to overcome those things that threaten to destroy the strength and the purity of the church so that God's work continues, so that the most important work in the world goes on, and so that the Lord is served in the way that He should be. Do you see the threats that endanger the strength and the purity of the church? Guard against these things. If you would, take out your songbook and open to the song that's been selected. Number 829 is a song of encouragement and invitation. What are you doing to strengthen the church? What are you doing to make sure that it is kept pure and presentable before the Lord in the way that it should be? Are there changes that need to be made? If you're a child of God and you recognize that you've fallen short, that instead of being a strength to the church and to the Lord's work, that maybe you've been a hindrance. If you recognize instead of working to keep the church pure, maybe you've been guilty of bringing worldliness into the church, and maybe you've been guilty of doing things that a child of God should not be doing. We call upon you, if that's the case tonight, to make correction. Correct it on the Lord's terms. We're told in 1 John chapter 1 and verse 9 that as Christians, if we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Maybe you need to make confession of sin tonight and seek the Lord's forgiveness. We would love to help you with that if that's your need. If you have never obeyed the gospel, if you've never been baptized into Christ for the remission of your sins, as the Bible teaches, you need to think seriously about that tonight. Now, there are a lot of people that will say, "Oh, you don't need to be baptized. Just believe. Just accept Jesus as your Savior." Well, Jesus said, "He who believes and is baptized will be saved." Mark 16, verse 16. And maybe you need to take advantage of the Lord's offer of salvation by coming to Him on His terms and obeying the gospel tonight. We'd love to help you to do that if that's your need this evening. If we can assist with these spiritual needs, why don't you come down to the front while we stand and while we sing.